Hi, everybody. This is Marlene from Miami Ghost Chronicles. And once again, I have a great show for you. I have a guest that is going to talk about a subject that is very, very interesting. And I have a lot of people asking me about this, and it's called spiritual warfare and territorial warfare. And her name is Carmen Lopez. And what's going to happen is, because I asked her, I said, Carmen, you know what? I want you to start with the basics, because there's a lot of people out there that really don't know that much about it. So she's agreed. She's going to take us from the beginning, explaining what it is and how it works, basically the basics of it, and then take us into examples and all her stories she's done. She's been in this field for many, many years. She's gone to other countries to work with other teams in other parts of the world on spiritual warfare, territorial warfare. But anyway, I'm going to bring her on now, and we'll get this started, because I think you're going to find this is one of the most interesting shows that I've done so far. Hey, Carmen, how are you doing?
Real good, Marlene, and yourself?
Great, great. You know, I tried to give a little bit of introduction as to what you do, but I was thinking before we get started, if you could tell my viewers a little bit about yourself, okay, and now and how you've ended up doing, you know, this in your, you know, as far as part of your ministry with the spiritual warfare and the territorial warfare.
Okay. I received Christ very early in my life, and I was 20. But 20 years later, I was 40, and I was seeing that certain things have not broken off my life.
Okay.
You know, so then as I started praying and asking God to show me people that know how to break off family curses, habits, what have you, I started inquiring. God led me to several people that were talking exactly for what I was seeking.
Okay.
So then I started learning about spiritual warfare and territorial warfare. They're two different things.
Okay.
But by me learning spiritual warfare, I was able to learn how to break certain generational curses that were on my life.
So in other words, 20 years after, you realize there's some answers that I don't have.
Exactly.
Okay. I've gone this far, but there's something here that I'm missing. And when you started exploring, you found, okay, this I think is where part of what I feel is not quite right for me. This is the answer. This is what I wasn't getting before. Okay. And I think that speaks also for a lot of people, that sometimes they do lead a spiritual life or a good life, but then they also feel like there's something that is not quite there, you know? And, you know, sometimes they don't have somebody to go and ask about, like, you know, or maybe their clergy or their pastor, they think, what if I ask this person? They might get offended thinking I'm like criticizing them because I'm missing something. So you went ahead and you took the step and you basically found something additional to what you already had in your spiritual practice. And you said something now about generational curses. And what can you tell me more about that?
Yes. This wasn't a very popular subject in the church 20 years ago. Even today, it's not a popular topic. It's just that in my spirit, I knew there was more.
Okay.
I knew there was more that I wasn't taught. I wasn't taught because the people teaching didn't know this.
Okay.
But by praying and searching, God opened the doors and I met people who were teaching exactly what I needed to learn. Reason being is, for example, in my life, in my personal life, in both sides of my family, mother and father, both my grandmothers were witches.
Okay.
How do you define a witch? Well, one of them practiced Santeria in Cuba, you know, with the killing of animals and chicken and the whole nine yards.
Okay.
And the other one called herself a spiritualist.
Okay.
So, in the end result, they're both sister cousins. I mean, they're both witches.
Okay.
But I saw things in me that I couldn't advance. There was like a stoppage in the spirit that wouldn't help me move forward to more liberty. For example, health.
Okay, so basically what you're telling me is that you felt like, okay, I've come this far, but I have this barrier, and it's tied into what my ancestors did or what they practiced. Even though I wasn't around, technically, you know, I wasn't born yet. You're saying that that carries through to people in the present time. Is that what
yes.
you're
saying? Yes, Marlene, it does, because you see, we are spirit beings. Everything around us, you know, we're so used to being flatlanders, meaning we move forward and backwards, mm-hmm. that we forget the notion that in the spirit world, there is a top and there is a bottom, and there is no time and there is no space.
Okay.
It's eternal. So whatever my grandparents did that was wrong, according to God and to the scriptures, mm-hmm. you know, that carries on to the third and the fourth generation.
Okay.
The Bible clearly states that the sins of the fathers are to the third and fourth generation, but my blessing is up to the 1,000 generation.
Okay. And let me ask you something, Carmen. I'm gonna interrupt you real quick. What would you tell somebody who doesn't really know who their grandparents or their ancestors were? One, either an adoption, or sometimes, you know, you just, there's a disconnection and you really don't know who one part of your family is. And what would you say if somebody suspects that that might be, you know, something that's going on for them, but they're not really sure because they just don't have access to the information as to who were the people that they come from? What do you tell people like that?
Well, I didn't have a whole lot of help. I started asking near relatives, near family members,
okay.
because I was born in Miami and my grandparents were from Cuba and died before I really knew them.
Okay.
So, and it's not like I could travel to Cuba and explore my family line, my bloodline.
Okay.
So I started by asking my mother, then asking my father, then asking older brothers, sister, cousins, whomever was associated to the family.
Okay.
And started plugging in things.
So you started piecing it together, almost like a clue, like you did. You became a detective, in other words, about your background.
Yes. It took me time.
Okay.
It took me time because first I was in a learning curve. I was learning myself.
Okay.
About the spirit world, you know, to break things over us. To break, for example, addiction of mm-hmm. any type. First, you go to the spirit world and you break it there before you're able to break it in the natural. Why?
Okay.
Because somebody in my family line practiced or had an addiction.
Okay.
Everybody has memory. You know, the earth has memory. We've learned in science that, for God's sake, plants have memories. That's why I say talk to the plants.
Yeah, yes, there's a lot of people that absolutely that they and it's almost like they say everything is connected, you know. We tend to think of everything as being separate because that's what our eyes tell us. But in reality, we're more connected with, like you said, the trees, and everything binds us together, you know, as far as knowledge and memory, place memory.
And since you said that, trees and things, everything has memory because we did come from the dirt.
Right.
God created man from the dirt of the earth. You know, and it's amazing that the body is 70% water.
Right.
You know, we were created from the same material that the earth exists in.
Okay.
So everything is spiritual. Everything has memories. That's why it says, talk to your plants. Talk to your animals. Talk to your house. Tell it how beautiful it is.
Absolutely.
Even to the most smallest atom, up to the smallest subatomical, it's 99% air. And even
exactly.
that has memory. And it's always moving, always changing.
Okay, absolutely. That, yes, that, like I said, that, you know, we don't live in that apart thing that that all these things around us, you know, that there is an exchange, even of vibrations of love, you know, like
yes.
you said, that, you know, when you thank, you're thankful and things like that, that, you know, some people could say, oh, there's cuckoo, you know, but no, but it does. There is something there. I personally believe it. I do believe that, you know, being thankful or being appreciative or being kind to animals or the trees or everything, I think it works. I feel better when I do it. So absolutely, I understand where you're coming from on that. And this, because this leads on to what you were talking about as far as how things that are kind of maybe unseen influence us. It's starting with what you were saying, that what your ancestors or your family that even you might have never met, how they can influence what's happening to you now in your life.
Absolutely. Unless I step into it and take responsibility for it and repent for their actions before God.
Okay.
That breaks. You know, breaking generational curses, Merlene, is a revelation. Okay. A revelation. God will do anything to set a person free from sickness, disease, poverty, bitterness, roots of rejection, people who are come from broken marriages, women who've been abused, men that have been abused.
Yeah, sure, of course.
God will break anything. His biggest desire is to see his creation free. So breaking generational curse is a revelation. However, the main revelation for a believer in Christ is in communion and taking daily communion. And I'll get there in a little while and explain communion.
Okay.
But you asked me, how did I stumble upon this? It's okay. Just that I saw a pattern in my life that
okay.
wasn't breaking, no matter how much I prayed or no matter how much I did. After time, I saw how other people excelled and I wasn't.
Right. And you listened to your instinct, because I guess something told you, there's something here I'm missing.
I knew it was inside your spirit. You know, God gave us all a spirit because Father God is the creator of spirits. Satan is not a creator of spirits because he himself is a created being.
Okay.
People put a lot of emphasis, oh, Satan. Well, I tell you what, he's not even an archangel.
What is he?
You know, cherubim.
Okay.
He's not an archangel. He is powerful and he has authority where we open the door and give him legal access to us.
Okay.
But for those of us who have received Christ as Savior by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, power has been given unto us that in the name of Jesus, all demons, all oppression has to go.
Okay, and let me ask you, when you were talking about all these different things that could have their roots, okay, mm-hmm. And you said poverty, do you think that, you know how sometimes people would take vows of poverty, you know, like before?
Yes.
I mean, people didn't take them with the intention of being bad. They were thinking that by taking a vow of poverty, they were thinking they were going to be closer to God, not knowing that, you know, poverty doesn't have to, that the only way you can be close to God is to live an impoverished life.
That is a great point, Marlene, because people innocently mm-hmm. have invoked and pronounced, named themselves, you know, making a covenant of poverty. They themselves cursing themselves.
Right. Not with the intentions of a curse, with the intentions they think that they're getting closer to God because they're choosing to be poor.
Whereas in God, you know, in Christ Jesus, it is much better as a good loving father that all your needs be met. What happens when your needs be met? You will do your best to meet other people's needs.
Sure.
Feed other people. Help other people. Save the animals. Save the children. Give your time to the church, work in organizations who are doing things for against sex trafficking.
Exactly. If you're not in that daily struggle
And
for
the daily grind of off to work I go because I owe, and get off the Ferris wheel and say, wait a second, God wants me prosperous
Yes. Yes,
and well and healed.
and I know that there's still a lot of people that struggle with that, where for them, and unfortunately that was pushed very much that being poor was, going to make you more worthy, or that God saw you more worthy if you were poor. And it's like, not really. There's nothing there that why would God want you to be poor and be struggling for your daily existence, and for your family? It doesn't make sense, but it's one of those things that a lot of people and a lot of families passed on one to the other, as like a core belief. And like you said, and then people have taken it and believe it. They believe it to the point where, like, then later on, when they become adults, they can't understand why they can't move forward financially, no matter how hard they try. And like you were explaining, maybe the roots of it are further back in your family line.
Through the Catholic Church, like you said earlier, they meant well, but they invoked those words and they prayed, and now, boom, the curse is there in the mother. You will see the same curse pattern in the daughter, in the son, in the grandchildren. Why? Until somebody repents and says, you know what? God made me prosperous because he wants me to have enough for myself and to meet your needs.
Exactly.
Because the Bible talks about giving. How can you give when you're broke?
No, you're having a hard time giving to yourself. How could you give to anybody else?
Bible
If
says that.
you're worried about, putting food on your own table. So yes, I totally understand that, and I think that that's a difficult concept, Carmen, for people sometimes to grasp, because a lot of times I'm gonna use poverty as an example, even though you named a bunch of different things, but a lot of people think that poverty is like, how hard are you trying? And like you said, sometimes people are really trying hard and they're working hard and they're doing everything they can to make it, and somehow they just never get over that hump. Okay, and I think that your approach, which is very interesting, I want you to talk more about that. Even though there's a lot of different areas that it covers, is like that one area that they just never think to look, and could explain so much why they just keep on not being able to go further.
Yes, well, as an add-on, not only is it that they made a vow of poverty, if in the bloodline there were shaky businesses, meaning my grandfather had a shaky grocery store and always cheated people on giving him the right amount, let's say rice or beans. That's a legal action to say, hey, you know what? I just cheated and I gave that man less than what I'm supposed to. That in itself is an open door. We'll call that an open door to give legal access to the devil, like in a court system, to say, hey, look, this person stole. So you know what? Her generation is cursed to the third and the fourth. It's not God doing it. It's just that he has legal, the devil has legal access, like in a court system, to say, hey, look, I can curse them because they stole. Or said to someone, you know what? Can I borrow money from you? I need money. And by good faith, you gave them $100. And you took the 100 different people, and your intentions were never to pay back. What happens in the bloodline and the spirit line? Those people suffered not having that money returned back to them. And because they suffered, that opens a door, like in the court system, the devil comes before God. The devil could come before God and does come before God. He is the accuser of the brethren. Notice that it doesn't say the accuser of the world, the accuser of the brethren, and say, hey, God, so and so stole and never paid back money and created grief in that family. That's an open door for the devil to come in and curse that family to the third and the fourth generation. And there's nothing they could do. There's nothing God could do until someone repents for that.
Now, let me ask you, what would your advice be, let's say, for somebody who, what would be a description? I mean, in other words, I don't want to give an easy out to somebody and say, oh, you know, the things haven't been working out for me because my grandpa, you know, did something wrong. Because that might not be the answer. The problem might be you're not trying hard enough. But what would you describe as being some of the signs that people could look for that would give them a hint, like, you know what, maybe you need to look at this aspect because this is where the problem could lie for you in your spiritual life or whatever it is. What do they look for?
I will look for patterns.
Okay.
You know, I will look at how was my grandparents when it came to money? How was my parents when it came to money? How am I when it comes to money?
Okay.
There's a pattern. Just like if there's a pattern of divorce in my family life, I would look and say, how was my grandparents? Oh, they were divorced. How was my parents? Oh, they were divorced. Boom. And you could go, you know, you could ask. I mean, you could ask around your family and you would find out patterns. I look for patterns. For example, in my family bloodline, my grandmother had asthma.
Okay.
And asthma is not one of those diseases that is generic in the blood.
Okay.
But yet, because she was a witch. Or she had asthma. We'll call asthma a curse because asthma is not a blessing.
Yeah, of course.
Asthma, her granddaughter has asthma. Her son has asthma. Other cousins of mine have asthma. And asthma was flowing all the way down from her.
Okay.
So when I learned this, I remember one of my nephews, the doctors gave a diagnosis that he was going to be asthmatic. We said, no, no. We take authority over this in the name of Jesus. And we repent that our grandmother practiced witchcraft because she didn't know any better.
Okay.
More than likely, the gospel was not preached to her. She lived in a little town in Cuba.
Okay.
So more than likely, it wasn't preached to her. So in the name of Jesus, I repent for that sin of my grandmother. So that makes me clean before the courthouse of God. I repented. So now that gives me authority in the name of Jesus to say, you know, Father, in the name of Jesus, I believe and I declare that that's broken in the spirit realm over my life and over my nephew. And you know what? He never did have it. And that happened not to one nephew, but to two nephews.
Now, what would you say, though, to somebody who does have either an illness or a disease that really is legitimately organic? How can you tell? It has nothing to do with something somebody in your family line did. This is just part of the human condition. People get sick. The human body gets sick.
Everything has a root.
Okay.
There's nothing organic. Everything has a point of origin in the spirit. But that's another class that I teach called Iniquity.
Okay.
Breaking generational curses.
Okay. So in other words, you're saying that even diseases or illnesses is that they can say, okay, this is the disease or this is what's happening in your body. You're saying that at some point you can go back in to that there's a spiritual component, which is
yes.
Where it starts from. And then, it shows up in the body as either an illness or something, you know, something wrong. But people people leave it at after going to the doctor and getting a diagnosis and they think, okay, well, that's it, you know.
Exactly. And they buy into that. Well, that is a manifestation, but there was a cause. Because I said earlier, everything is spiritual.
Okay.
Everything is spiritual. That's why we go to the spirit world first and declare and break things off. And they will manifest in the natural world. As a matter of fact, me talking to you is something that happened already in the spirit realm.
Okay.
You know, computers is not an invention of man of documenting. It already existed in heaven because the Bible says that daily angels open books and read about what you and I are to do day by day, even the path that we cross, even the water that we drink. Nothing's by coincidence, no such thing.
Okay, so, you know? So, and what you were saying is that it's that time is not measured the way we measure it. Like,
no. God and man, God, for a man is a day, for God it could be 1,000 year. For something to be called deity, number one, it can't be man. Number two, it has to be out of time and space.
Okay.
And we're beings that have a time, a lifetime, you know, 80, 85 years, 90, 100, you know. That's why Jesus was the only one out of Muhammad, out of all the other gods, that says that was resurrected from the dead. Muhammad was a man who lived and died.
Right.
And so was Gandhi was a man who lived and died. So was, you know, the leader of the Muslim movement was a leader who lived and died.
Okay.
But Jesus is the only one that said that was resurrected from the dead. And not only that, but people miss out that after he was resurrected, 3 days later, he came back to earth and was here 40 days and 40 nights giving instructions to the people. And that's okay. in the book of Acts.
So what you're saying, though, is, you know, as far as the spiritual warfare, because basically you've laid out now, and I'm very curious about this, because according to what you told me, and I know you're giving like a simple overview, you know, whether you identify it or you suspect it, because let's say for some reason you can't absolutely know, but you kind of feel, okay, you know what, this is coming from something from my ancestral line or whatever it is that you're dealing with now, that all it needs is an act of repentance. Is there, you know, let me ask you, because and is there at times some type of resistance to it? You see what I'm saying? Or is it just even from within you? You know, even from with somebody that this is, you know, like you said, you might have had this in your family for years and generations.
Well, my greatest desire, number one, a person has to want to be free.
Okay.
I can't buy freedom from anybody. Neither can Jesus.
Okay.
You got to want to be free.
Yeah, of course.
You have to have a desire to excel. What is the will of God for my life, for anybody's life? God's will in our life, number one, is that we live in divine health and healing, not depending on the pharmaceutical industry.
Okay.
Number two, God's will is that we have a good marriage.
Okay.
God's will is that our children are obedient and not rebellious. God's will is all good and favorable towards me. So anything that creates a struggle in me is not of God.
And that's, in other words, what you're saying is, now, let me, and you made a very good point. Let's look at it from the, when you said addiction, you know,
yes.
How some people sometimes they struggle with addiction. And, you know, it's well recognized that there is a genetic component to addiction. You know what I'm saying? In other words, if you have family that had addiction problems, it doesn't guarantee that you're going to be an addict, but it's easier for you to fall into addiction. But what you're saying is that this goes beyond genetics.
Yes.
That this goes into, now, you also pointed out, and the reason why I say this is that because of addiction, the nature of addiction, like you said, you have to really want it. But your body is, you know, part of you is probably thinking, I don't want to give this up. You know, I do want to continue in this. What would you suggest to somebody who it's something that their body craves? And let me give you an example. Wanting to, let's say, do better financially, everybody wants that. You know, I even though some people have behavior that keeps them there, you would think, okay, everybody wants that. It's like they don't have to second guess it. But when, let's say, you're talking addiction, when you have somebody that maybe desperately wants it, but at the same time, there's a part of them that still wants to hold on to it for whatever reason, is there an intervention that happens so that person can break free and make that decision? Or how does that work?
The person's got to want to give it up.
Okay.
Say it's the addiction of cocaine. Say it's the addiction of gambling.
Sure, yeah, that's an addiction.
Here's another addiction, food.
Yeah, yes.
Obesity, an excess of food, that's an addiction.
Yes, it is.
Addictions come in many different forms, but point being is that the person needs to say, I want to be free and fight for it. And then once they're delivered, fight to stay free.
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. With an addiction, yes, that definitely is like, okay, once you get there, once you're over that hump, how do you stay, what they call in the addiction community, a clean and sober life. But sobriety doesn't necessarily mean, because like you said, if you have an addiction to food or gambling or whatever, it's staying on that path where you don't take go back
That
to what's familiar to you.
exactly. And how do you do that? You can't get something out of our temple. Our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Okay.
You can't get something out. You can't get a spirit out of you
Okay.
without replacing it. You
Okay.
replace that emptiness. Let's call it an emptiness, like a donut.
Right. Like something, you took something out, so now there's a
A
gap, an
hole.
area that's empty where what that used to be before.
What do I feel it with? I fill it with praise, worship, thanksgiving, attending church, hearing the word of God, speaking the word of God, singing. I crave and hold on to what Christ did for me. And I change my surroundings. There's
Okay.
friends that we don't need. There's relatives we don't need.
Okay.
There's places that we don't need to go to stay out of addiction and create a new life for us. But that's called changing our mind,
Yeah.
renewing our mind to a new way of living, a new way of life.
Now, let me ask you something, Carmen. What do you think? Let's say somebody's undergoing this change, that they're doing it, they realize, I'm going to make this type of spiritual change because whatever it is, whether it's addiction, whatever.
Okay.
Is there a danger that evil, the devil, whatever you want to call it, is going to try to interfere in that? Is there any danger of that, or want
Oh,
to not let you
that's
progress, in other words?
most assuredly, because it's two kingdoms in one choice. It's the kingdom of darkness and the
Okay.
kingdom of light. And your choice is whether I want to live in the kingdom of light, of the true living God, or live in the kingdom of darkness where the demons dwell. I have to make that choice because there's one thing that God gave to all mankind that neither God can touch nor the devil can touch. And that's called the free will.
Oh, sure, of
He gave
course.
us a free will because he's not a dictator for us to choose. We either choose light or we choose darkness. And in everything, that is a spiritual warfare right there. It's the warfare is on. Okay, I want to break the addiction of eating. What do I do? Number one, you have to say, I want this spirit out of me in the name of Jesus. Go to church, find a church that believes in this. Have
Okay.
brothers pray for you. Attend church. So why? So that way you have spiritual nourishing.
Okay.
Second, I was at search, there's so much YouTube videos on what is junk food. Eliminate your refrigerator from junk food and
Okay.
replace it with healthy food and tap on to a healthy lifestyle and join clubs. There's a lot of clubs that teach you how to cook and how to eat,
In other
and
words, what you're saying is, don't just pray about it. You got
do
to do the
something about it.
practical work.
That's the warfare. You got the spirit out of you, spirit of overeating, gluttony. I cast you out in the name of Jesus. Now the battle's on. Now it's up to your will to say, I want to go to Publix and start eating greens and start eating vegetables and fish and learn how to make it and ask God, God, change my taste buds. Teach the teach changing me the way I think and I view things.
Okay.
And I keep myself in a thankful position. Lord, thank you that you're changing my body. Lord, thank you that each day my body progresses and I like the greens and I like the vegetables and I like good food. No, I don't like sodas. You know, by Thanksgiving, that alone itself is a spiritual warfare that benefits the believer.
So, Carmen, how do you think, or what are the ways that, like you said, it's warfare, and you know that saying, all is fair in love and war?
Oh yeah,
Hold on a minute. I've got a dog that I need to rescue. Hold on. Hold on. Sorry, everybody, but I have my little dog back there, as you can see, my little Chihuahua. And about a month ago, she took a fall off the same bed. It cost me $600. That's why I put her back where she goes. It's like, little dog, please. I can't afford another fall. Okay, hold on. So, Carmen, okay, so let me ask you, what are the things, like you said, this is a path. This is a process. This is the not only the decision, but making the choices. What are the things that the devil, anybody was going to throw at you get you right back to where you were before?
The devil uses your relatives.
Yeah. Go with it. I mean, yes, I'm sure there's a lot of people going, I get it. I get that. Yeah.
Your sister will knock on your door and say, hey, look what I got you, a chocolate cake.
Okay.
Friends that it's been months that you haven't spoken to, suddenly call you and say, hey, come on my treat. Let's go have ribs, you know? Hey, let's go have some chicken wings. Hey, you know, let's go to the Chinese buffet, you know, and buffet your body. You know, you start getting invitations from the woodworks. You know, and wherever you go, you see a big burger, you know, and this burger now has a voice and eyes and eat me, buy me.
Yeah. Calls you by name, right?
Calls you by name, you know, but that's where those of us who have overcome and have received the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ is not just a mental ascend. He has seated in the throne of our spirit. He is Lord of us, spirit, soul, and body. Have authority to say no, no in the name of Jesus. Lord, help me. And start praising God. Hang up the phone. Tell your sister, thank you for the cake. Then throw it away. You know, you have to make decisions.
Sure, yeah. It's tough sometimes.
We are responsible for making right decisions.
Okay.
You know, just like we can make wrong decisions, we're responsible to make right decisions. But the power of God is with us to do that. And it'll be hard the first week, the first 2-3 weeks. But after a month, guess what? You start seeing changes in your body. You'll feel better about yourself. You've now tagged on to friends in Facebook who teach you how to use avocado as a spread with tuna instead of mayonnaise. And you see all the benefits. And you start worshiping God. Before you know it, guess what? You look behind you, and that temptation won't be there.
So in other words, what you're saying is that, you know, and the reason why I'm going to point this out is that sometimes we live in an instant gratification expectations, that we want things to manifest like this, like in a moment. So what you're saying is this is a process that you're going to have to do on a daily basis. And then slowly, gradually, you start seeing all these, like you said, certain people come into your life that are beneficial to you, or you come across information which is helping you and things of this nature. Now, let me ask you, let's say for somebody who's been engaged in risky behavior, they're hanging out with the wrong people, maybe possibly drug use, maybe even crime. What happens to those people where it's not like you said, like, I'm going to throw away the chocolate cake my sister gave me, you know, where, you know, you might be dealing with people who are dangerous. And believe me, the last thing they want is they might be using you in some way. What advice do you give to somebody, which I imagine that you're going to have more spiritual interference than maybe somebody else that, you know, especially if you're engaged in something that's dark like that?
Well, I remember at 18, when no, I wasn't. I was 21, working for a corporation, and I was involved in the discotheque time and Donna Summers and the disco and the pot and the cocaine and the drinks. And suddenly inside of me, I knew I was headed for the wrong path.
Right. Like that you have that epiphany, that moment that you're going, oh.
Yes, and it was growing. It wasn't a sudden hit. It was a little voice inside of me saying, if you don't change and get off this merry-go-round, you're
Okay.
going to have bad consequences. Bad consequences. And out of nowhere, my brother starts talking to me about Jesus. I'm like, okay, I don't got a problem with Jesus. Jesus is a nice man. Now, what do you He goes, but you have to make a commitment to Christ. Now, I didn't like that word commitment. Because God's asking you to make a commitment with Christ, to live Christ-like. And that's hard to do when your body really enjoys the disco and really enjoys the friends that you have and the lifestyle that you have. But inside of you, you're heading into a bad road. But as the church started praying for me and my brother started praying for me, wherever I went, I had some Christian testify to me about Christ. I'd get out of the disco, and wouldn't you know it, on my windshield, there'll be a little paper that says, Jesus loves you. So
Okay,
that
so you're
was
like,
like, wow,
okay.
what is this? I'm happy with my sin. But we're happy where we're at. But all those of us who are were partaking or are partaking of this, they know. We know inside of us that at the end, it's not going to be very good. So I was young and I was making decisions that was going to form my life. And I got to tell you, it's never too late. It's never too late to change because God created everyone with a unique purpose, a purpose that only they can fulfill, a
And
destiny.
I'm glad you pointed that out because, that example that you gave when you said, like you were 20 years old, and a lot of people say, oh, yeah, because, when you're that age, you make mistakes and, you kind of straighten yourself out. What do you tell people who have basically lived almost their entire life, whether they're 40, 50, 60, 70 years old, and is, like you said, it's not too late for them either, right?
Absolutely never too late because God created everyone with a specific design and purpose that they alone can fulfill. So at 60 years old, so what? You can start preaching the gospel in missions. You can start being a host on a radio show. You can teach other people how to be free of addictions. You can preach at the jail to the youth. You can work and do so many things for the gospel that God has already predestined you in heaven that you would do. And he's waiting on you. So it's never too late.
So there, or in other words, yeah, there is never that, like that, that saying, oh, I'm too old for that. No, if there comes a moment where you say, hey, you know what? Maybe I've lived all my life, battling these demons or having these problems, whatever they are, whatever. I'm not gonna be there. You can always have that moment where you decide you're gonna make a change, and you're never gonna get the, oh, it's too late,
Absolutely never. I mean, there's some people who today are sick in their flesh and it manifests, let's say it manifests as a let's say it manifests as a back pain.
Okay.
The root to back pain is pride. And if we could search our hearts, we all have a level of pride in our lives.
Sure.
Just like women who suffer from glands in their breast, when you look on the root of this, and I've been 20 years, searching this, the root of that is a lack of unforgiveness.
Okay.
When you speak to them, you start asking questions to see where things coming from. Is there someone you haven't forgiven? Oh, yes, I haven't forgiven my father because my father divorced my mother. And you will see that there's a someone that they can't ever forgive.
Yeah, so something they, right that they carry, like they say that they carry it in their chest area. And
very good. They carry it in their chest. Yeah. Just like bitterness.
Yes.
You see, you know, in old people, you see what has affected their lives by their expression. Do they look sad? Do they look happy? Do they look bitter?
Yes. Yeah.
It's roots of bitterness that stem from a divorce, from a husband that left you, a wife that left you, children. But there's a root of bitterness in our lives that we can't take out of us and say, here, God, this is yours now. Fill me with the joy of gladness.
Well, I imagine sometimes these people, after years of hanging on to this anger or this lack of forgiveness, it's almost like you want to keep it because, you know, being angry makes you feel like, you know, it's part of you, you know, and it's difficult to sometimes, I imagine, for people to understand, guess what, the root of maybe a symptom that you're showing in your physical body is an emotion.
Absolutely.
You know?
Or an emotion that, here, I heard a story from one of the pastors that I help counsel. She's out of Venezuela. She was telling me a story of a lady that was brought to her that was completely bent over. The lady actually walked with her hands and feet.
Wow.
So everybody had prayed for her and nothing was happening. And okay. She said, "Well, I would like to know what the root of this is." So she started fasting. The pastor started fasting and praying for this lady because we need to hear from God. We need to hear from the Holy Spirit. We need revelation, which in the book of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1, it says that he gives us a spirit of revelation, insight. You see, everything is spiritual. So she's asking God, where did this come from? And after 2 days of praying and fasting and giving thanks to God, she believed in her spirit that she heard unforgiveness.
Okay, so what you're saying is that
here's somebody praying for somebody else.
Okay, because so far, it's not that this lady was devoid of any good spiritual life. She was, but still there was this, nobody could come up with a reason of why she was had this back thing going on, and is what you're saying. So,
according to the pastor, she was completely bent over.
Oh.
So then they had a private session, and she said to her, "Do you really want to be free of this? Because this requires from you to give up hurts and pains from the past."
Good question, right? That right there is like, yep, yeah, that's a good question.
In other words, don't waste my time if you don't want to be free of this. And the lady said, "Yes, I wish to be free of this." She goes, "Whatever it takes." She said, "Whatever it takes."
Right.
So she was confronted then. She was confronted by truth. Why is it who in your life you have not forgiven? And the lady
started. Good question, right? Like, ha, 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 ha. Yeah.
And the lady, Marlene, this is real life, okay. Real situations. It happens to people.
Sure.
You know, we don't live in a little bubble. We've all been through hurts mm-hmm. of one type or another. So the lady starts balding and crying and crying. And after half an hour of crying, she was able to mumble and say that her father had sexually abused her.
There you go.
Mm-hmm. And then she was asked, "Can you forgive him?" Now, this took hours. This took like maybe 6 hours to get the lady to be able to say, "I forgive my father," by faith. Because sometimes you can't forgive someone totally. And mm-hmm. even that is in layers, in time. You know, you do it as an act of faith. By faith, I'm forgiving him. But as we get filled with the love of Christ, with the goodness of Christ, with the kindness of Christ, we start forgiving more and more and more. And when you look behind you, that pain is not there anymore, because nothing is a microwave prayer.
Okay.
You know, a baby takes 9 months to be conceived. You know, it's done in half an hour.
Right, yeah, but the final product.
The final product takes 9 months. Everything is gradual, and the Bible says it very clear. You know, you plant the seed, you water it, and in time, it sprouts out. Everything in life is a process. There's nothing, those fad diets don't work. Unless you pay the price, you're never going to be in control.
Right.
So this lady started again crying, and it took a process, but 6 hours later, that lady walked out of the church completely standing up.
Yeah.
As she laid on the floor crying, and sisters talking to her, giving her deliverance. This is the word, deliverance.
Okay.
Forgive so-and-so, forgive so-and-so. Who else you haven't forgiven? She started straightening up. It was a process.
Okay, so basically this anger.
This unforgiveness.
Right.
Caused a physical ailment in her body.
Wow. That
this happened to. You know,
and
so.
I know that a lot of people have a hard time believing that there's such a strong connection between emotions, what you think, and the symptoms that your body will show, you know, or, you know, things, like you said, not necessarily even a disease, but she was walking, you know, according to you, she was bent over.
Totally bent over. And I believe the pastor. I preached in that church many, many times.
Now, you said, you know, you used the word deliverance, Carmen.
Mm-hmm.
But is this deliverance in the, because a lot of people think of deliverance as in like the casting of spirits or something like this. Is this the same thing or is this something different?
It's the same thing. Lack of unforgiveness is a spirit.
Okay.
That has talked to her ear for years saying, your father, you can't forgive him. Oh, your father did this to you and you can't forgive him and you can't talk to no one about it because it's shameful. It's shameful that your father used you sexually.
Okay.
So she grew up in shame. So that devil ministered to her ear night and day for many years.
Okay.
So it is that. It is a devil. It is a spirit. We live in a spiritual world.
Okay.
You know, it wasn't God doing that to her. It was
right, right. So it's not just the act of her forgiving her father. It's also, there's a deliverance part, which is what you were saying, that the people around her were doing for her.
They were helping her by saying, who else you haven't forgiven? Okay. I haven't forgiven my brother for so-and-so. I haven't forgiven this. I have shame. That's a big word that people hide in them, men and women. I have shame. But as she spoke it, she brought it to the light.
Okay, right. And that's where it loses its power.
It loses its power. Once you bring that from inside you, what's in darkness, and you shine light on it, poof, it goes away. You know, rejection is also another one. You know, that woman was going through rejection as well.
Yeah, especially from somebody as a child, I imagine that can cause a lot of problems.
And I believe in a lot of people that I have spoken to who've gotten deliverance from being gay.
Right.
When I speak to them, someone in their youth has molested them. That opened a door in the spirit realm where that devil is able to minister to that person or speak to his ear saying, you know what? You like men. You know, you like men. This happened to you. You can't talk about it. It's shameful. But I just see a big correlation there.
Okay.
I see girls who I have ministered to who wanted to be free. That's the word. Who wanted to be free.
Okay.
From lesbian lifestyle. When I speak to them, a root cause is abandonment, normally by the father.
Okay.
You know, rejection sets in, shame. The man that's supposed to be a godly figure to her, a father's a provider. He covers, he takes care of girls, of their daughters. That figure's not there. That rejection settled in. Something happened where no father, no mother.
Okay.
You know, I just see, I look for parallels. You know,
And Carmen, what do you, let me ask you, because I know there's a lot of people out there. Do people ever have a physical manifestation? Because people will say, you know what, especially when they're going through what they think is either a spiritual or demonic, where they actually visually see something horrible or bad close to them. Is this part of what you're talking about, where there's a physical manifestation that they see it, not just something that they feel, in other words, that basically you see proof of it outside of your body? Is that possible?
I've seen manifestations. Okay. I don't know if the person has, but I have, as an example, I was someplace ministering, and these two brothers, young, they were like 18, 21, wanted prayer.
Okay.
And I said, okay. So I prayed for one, and suddenly the kid falls to the floor.
Okay.
Falls to the floor and starts groaning.
That was a manifestation. I was like, oh boy.
Okay. This was a manifestation. And that, you know, everybody's wanting to stand him up. I'm like, for God's sake, don't stand him up. Leave him on the floor and sit on him. So I had two guys sit on him so he wouldn't move. He became very aggressive, okay, wanting to grab my legs. So then I started praying.
Okay.
I started praying because this is not like Hollywood. Get out of me, Satan. You know, you come out. You know?
No, it doesn't work like that.
First, I got to go to God and say, God never uses the same method to deliver one person. That's why one of my classes is how to hear the voice of God, how to hear the voice and the leadings of God in your spirit. You know, because we have spiritual antennas inside of us, in our spirit. So I asked the Holy Ghost, God, what do I do here? It's almost midnight. I really don't want to be here. And this guy is yelling in the floor. You know?
Okay.
It so happened to be that it was in the backyard. And he's loud. And all the dogs start barking. Woo, 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 woo. Like,
I can imagine you were like, this is, yeah. I imagine in a way it's creepy. It's scary. You know, as much as you don't want to think of it that way. You know, especially when somebody starts acting like that.
Yeah. So then I asked, Lord, what would you do, Lord? How do I deliver this kid? So suddenly an epiphany took place inside of me, a knowing. And the knowing was, number one, that he was not born again. You know, he had a mental ascent of Jesus, but he wasn't born again. In other words, you can't have two masters in one house. Who's the house? Our body.
Okay.
You can't have two masters in one house. It's either light or darkness. I said earlier, it's two kingdoms, but one choice. So the devil's obviously oppressing him, but a person who's oppressed and demonized doesn't lose all his faculties.
Okay.
They always recognize their name. And I asked them, do you want to be free? You've had the devil for a few years. You can handle it a lifetime. But do you want to be free? And the kid said with his voice, he said, yes. And again, I grabbed his face in my hands. I said, look at me. Look at me. Do you want to be free? And again, he said, yes. What am I doing? We live, like I said earlier, we live in a spiritual world.
Okay.
Here you have light and darkness. Here you have angels and demons in the spirit. I said earlier that we have a free will.
Okay.
His free will was to be free. So this is what the Lord asked me to do. To cast the devil out of him himself.
Okay. And what did you do?
I said, I called, but I'm going to not mention his name. Say John Doe.
Right. That's fine.
John Doe. Tell that devil to leave you. Well, before that, let me go back. I asked him, you know what? You want to be free? He said, yes. I said, but you have to accept the Lord Christ in your life and throne him. I said, follow what I'm saying, but you got to mean it from your heart. Because whatever happens, God always looks at the heart. God always looks at the motivation of the heart, our intent. What is the intent? You know, so the kids started following and I walked them through. I said, Jesus, I throne you as my Lord over my soul. Jesus, I call you Lord over my spirit, my body. And this took a while.
Okay.
I would see that suddenly he would go a little further and suddenly he would faint. That wasn't him fainting. That was the devil being deceivious, because the devil is a liar and the father of lies, trying to knock the kid out. I said, no, you don't. You're not falling asleep on me. You're not passing out, because you're not passing out. So I would call the kid by his name.
Okay.
The spirit of the kid. The spirit of the kid, the one that has authority. Hey, hey, wake up. Look at me. Let's continue. And I let him through. He goes, I call myself born again. I'm washed by the blood of the Lamb. I reject every unclean spirit. And everything that God gave me at that time, I reject. And I took him through a little path of cleansing himself. And he rejected it himself.
Okay. Which I imagine is important, because like you said, this is where the free choice comes in. So in other words, if he didn't do it,
the darkness has to back out.
But in other words, what you're saying is, no matter how much you would want to help him, if he didn't accept it firsthand.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right. However, this process, which took 2 hours, as he started, you know, saying, I receive Christ as my Lord, seated in my throne, seated in my soul, in my spirit, in my body. I repent of ungodly acts. I repent of et cetera, et cetera. You see his face change.
Okay. How so? What kind of change did you see?
Softness came in. Clarity came in. His voice came back. His mind came back.
Okay.
Slowly we were able to get off of him. So, you know, and this took 2 hours. You know, at the end, he started crying, feeling, he said, I feel like something left me.
Okay.
Something left me. You know, and then I asked, what's the root of this?
Okay.
And since his aunt is a pastor, he says, I think I know how this happened to him. I said, how? He says, because I practice martial arts. You see, martial arts, when they ask you to meditate on the dragon, the cat, the tiger, they're all deities. And the moment that a person starts chanting and start meditating on that dragon, they open up themselves in the spirit realm. And they become demonized, like this kid did. So all that stuff in Grasshopper and how Hollywood has played it, all those kids get demonized. This kid was a product of that. And when he took me to his room, mm-hmm. he showed his karate sweaters with the dragon and the tiger and this. So guess what? He didn't practice that art anymore. He took up football instead. And 5 years later, he's got a girlfriend, is about to get married, and he's totally free.
Now, let me ask you that. Why do you think, even though I know he identified it as that, why couldn't it have been from another source? Why do you think it was only that?
Because, like I said earlier, transcendental meditation is a cult, and you end up channeling deities. And in the martial arts, you know, the dragon is a deity, the tiger, the cat, and so on and so on. And he channeled it. So that was the entrance way that that devil had.
Okay, so you're saying that that was the gateway that what happened.
Yes.
So, and I'm going to move on to something that we spoke about earlier, which I thought was very interesting, which was territorial warfare. Okay. And you mentioned something where that this is sometimes things that happens to the land, okay? And that sometimes people are unaware. Sometimes they're aware and sometimes they're unaware because they don't know the history, but they kind of walk into situations that has the basis, for lack of a better word, of where they're living at.
Yes, like I said earlier. You know, Marlene, you got to bring me back to your show
I know.
because I did three pages and you've had me all over the place.
Okay, I'm sorry. It's that I want to fit everything in, and I thought that, because it's
Was
almost
there.
like the spiritual part is almost like the human component. You know what I'm saying? The person. Okay.
The soul,
But
okay.
then when you said that thing about the territorial warfare, it's
Okay.
almost like the something else that affects the person, but is not necessarily the root of it is not them per se. It could be the area or the land or the, I don't know, that's what I understood,
Okay.
but that affects them,
Here's an example. Warfare is two-sided.
Okay.
When we say warfare, spiritual warfare is two-sided. One is in the inside, which what is what we've been talking about,
Right,
our
exactly.
soul, our bodies, us. The other one is outside. Outside, when you go out to your land, the fact that I go around my house, anointing it with oil, blessing it, that's territorial warfare.
Okay, right, which is what we talked about, which is this is the difference where one is the person's body. Okay.
And the
And
second,
this is something different. This is the place they inhabit.
the place they inhabit. It could be a country, it could be a land, it could be your house.
Okay.
Okay, for example, I was once in Venezuela on the borderline of Colombia and Venezuela. It's called Cúcuta, a very dark place because Cúcuta is known for sex trade. They sell women, they sell children. If you can think of it, it's sold there.
Okay.
It's a very dark place. Number one, and number two, the Venezuelans sell their goods to the Colombians, whatever it may be. But it's a dark border, a very dark border. So we were in Venezuela, like an hour from there, and we were praying. We were praying how to bless the land because there had been a lot of bloodshed in areas where there's been a lot of bloodshed. That area is cursed. And
Okay.
if you see it in the pictures and photos that I have, it's desolate, it's dirty, it's grimy, it has pigs, it has dogs barking that are not very well taken care of. It looks like a horror movie.
Okay.
Desolate. And I said, so we were praying how to bless the land, and what the Lord placed in my heart and in the pastor's heart, the one who invited me,
Okay.
was to go out and go to the river of these two countries and walk and pray and worship as much as we could. So we took a taxi, drove to the other side of Venezuela and Colombia.
Okay.
During that season, the river wasn't high. It was extremely low, like maybe a quarter of an inch.
Okay.
So we got down there and we started walking and we started anointing the waters with oil.
What kind of oils were you using? Do you remember?
Matter. No, it doesn't matter. It was olive oil, canola oil, it was oil.
Oh, so it's oil. Okay. I just wanted to know because I know people were asking themselves that, like, I wonder if there's a special oil that has to be used, but basically you're saying any oil. It's the intent.
It's the intent. You could use three things, but that's another class. Use oil, wine, and salt. But in this case, we used oil and we used wine. Wine
Okay.
typifies the blood of Jesus.
Okay.
Okay, so we anointed it. As w with one hand, I had the wine, and the other hand, I had the oil. And it was a team. A team went out to do this.
Okay.
We had guards praying for us. We had people watching out for us. You know, you do this in a
Yeah, the
team.
practical part of it, you need, yeah, you have to take care of yourself also. It's not like.
Right. We did this with a team that we were all in the same sequence, same spirit, who have spent 2 or 3 days praying for this.
Okay.
You know? So we went out there, we anointed with oil, we claimed the blood of Jesus, because this is what we saw. This is what we received in our spirits as we prayed about how to bless that particular land.
Carmen, and let me ask you, I know you said that there was a lot of trafficking of, you name it, people, whatever. Were there any people actually able to live there or no? Or was it
On
just.
either side, yes. On either side, in Venezuela and Colombia, people do live. But this is what happened. This is what happened. We anointed the area. We poured the wine, taking authority of spirit of violence, spirit of murder, spirit of bloodshed, spirit of prostitution, deceiving spirit, everything that came to our hearts that took place in that area. We asked God to bless it, to consecrate that area, to be a border of peace, where in the natural it would seem impossible. We declared it be an area of peace. No more murder, no more bloodshed, no more violence. And then we started singing. He gave us a song. Worship is the most powerful weapon anyone could use. So we started worshiping and we took shofars out there. Then I wondered, Lord, what are you going to do with this? Because all that is there in the spirit. At some point, God's going to use it. Well, you know, Googling today, this happened in September 8th, 2015.
Okay.
17,000 Colombians had to go back out of Venezuela into Colombia.
Okay.
Because President Maduro said, hey, guess what, Colombians? You can't live here in Venezuela. Of course, the benefit of living in Venezuela is that it's a lot cheaper to live there than it is in Colombia.
Okay.
So 17,000 people started crossing
Back into
this.
Colombia.
17,000 people, this is not a very big road. You're talking two lanes going, two lanes coming. You
Okay.
had the Venezuelan government on one side, you had the Colombian military on the other. You know, things looked very ugly, but this is something you can Google. No deaths took place.
Because normally this is a place where there wasn't only trafficking, but there was what, combat or people killing each other and.
People killing each other because of drugs and of corruption. The Colombians would buy vehicles full of food for the Venezuelans to sell up in the Colombia side because it was
Okay.
cheap. You know, if you could think of it, it took place in these borders. Always border countries in South America are very dark places. So 17,000 people, Venezuelan military, Colombian military, people having, by the way, a lot of people walked and took bicycles because they didn't. All their house, all their possessions, they took with them
Okay.
back to Colombia. These people had to set up tents, where to sleep in. You
Right.
know, there is no man's land. You find a little space, it's squatters. Boom, you make a little house, it's yours.
Okay.
But it blessed me to see, and the church to see, that in such a political climate that nobody died. There was a few fights.
Yeah, and I imagine that there have been years or traditions of discord and like, well, the worst discord, which is murder, the death of other human beings.
Yes. So it blessed me that what God asked us to do a year earlier, you know, 2 years earlier, here, this massive exile of people going through that place that nobody died. See, that brings glory to God. That brings glory to God that nobody died, nobody perishes. God is a God of peace.
Now, Carmen, let me ask you, what happens to somebody? And I want to put a more practical aspect to it. Like you said, this place, everybody knew that it was a borderline, a border between two countries, and you know, there was, if it was bad, it was being trafficked, so bloodshed, murder, you know, whatever. But let's look at the more practical. Let's say somebody, let's say here in the United States, you know, not in a place that you would know the history of it for being a bad area. How do you know if there might be that something l similar to that happened there? And of course, you innocently come along years later with no idea of what took place there. What do you tell somebody that could give you a hint if you're just, let's say you move to that part of the country, for example. You know, sometimes certain areas people say, oh yeah, that area, no, that happened. But let's say you just move there. You have no idea. You say, hey, you know what? I'm gonna get a house built, or that house, I'm gonna buy it.
I
What do
could
people
been,
look for? What is the sign that you might be running into problems because of something that happened there before?
well, you would see calamity. If you started to build a house or purchase a house, it's things are always breaking down.
Okay.
You would hear sounds in the house, things that you hadn't played, things that you haven't seen. You see movement in the house, not favorable ones.
Okay.
You plant something and it dies, nothing that you do, the house starts breaking down on you. That's not a blessing.
No, of course not. Yeah, I mean, everything has normal wear and tear, but I imagine you're saying something that, like, what are the odds of X amount of things maybe not working all at once, or.
What's the odd of a new house having a roof that when it rains, water comes in?
Right.
That's an example. And it must be also a lot more than that, you know, sinks overflowing, you know, major things like that.
Okay.
Was it built in a Indian reservation? Was it
Okay.
an old Indian burial ground? All Florida belonged to the Indians, and the Indians were very occultic people, you know. Was it a place that, what's the history of it? You know,
Okay.
you can inquire, you could find out demographics. As far as my house is concerned, I try to walk around my house with the oil, with the wine, blessing my house, coming against any spirit of robbery, theft, vandalism. I bless my house. I
Okay.
proclaim that it prospers, that nothing breaks down, that the walls last until I'm done with the house, that the roof stays intact, that the grass, I even pray that there'll be no bugs.
Yeah, why not? Absolutely.
Well, why not? I had a circumstance where I do not like frogs. And since I live behind a lake, I would come home and guess what? I had these big toads in the front
Yeah, I
porch.
imagine. Yeah, of course.
That was not a welcoming sign. You know, I would walk in this big toad. I would have to clap and find a stick to. I said, until one day the Lord put in my heart, why am I allowing this? I'm like, what do you mean, Lord? He goes, you have authority over the frogs. And I came to my sense and I said, that's right, I do. And I said, in the name of Jesus, all these frogs and toads are cursed and they're to leave my property. This is my property. God gave this to me in the name of Jesus. After that, Marlene, I hardly see a toad. I hardly see a frog.
Well,
In
and
hot summer months, I might see one or two, but I had like 10, 15 in the front porch.
they're all waiting for you when you got home, like, hey, there she is. Hello.
Yes. And I call the animals to come into my property.
Okay.
You know, I says I live behind a lake, there's birds, there's turtles, and some nice iguanas. And I say, iguanas and turtles, come to my house. The presence of the living God is here. The same God that created me created them.
Of course.
And they recognize this. They're a lot smarter than we are. Because we use logic.
Well, yeah, of course. And
So
Carmen, what
I've actually
advice would you give somebody Who's gonna buy, not build, I'm talking about buying a house, that's already been constructed. And let's face it, the most you're gonna get if you look at government records is who are the owners, but you really have no idea what the actual, either what happened on the land or what happened in that structure before you came. Unless it made the headlines somewhere, you really don't know.
Well,
What's your advice to somebody who's out there, who's purchased a home? Is there something that they should do before they move in?
Marlene, yes. Bless their land. Bless their land. If it's a believer, you can have a santero buy the property.
Okay.
Bless it. Not going to happen. Only short-lived ones. It's not going to happen very long. Unless somebody who practices the occult moves next door. And you can tell their houses are spooky.
Okay.
They have these vivid colors, blue, green, for reasons. But at any rate, I'll give you an example also. My neighbor,
Okay.
she's into witchcraft. So on Sunday, I hear some sounds and I knew off the bat they were chanting by the lake. So I go back
Oh,
there.
because he has access to his from his yard to the lake as well.
Well, I live in a zero lot line,
Right.
and on a zero lot line, you can see what he's barbecuing.
Yeah, exactly. Right. I know what you mean. I know what you mean.
We have fences, wood fences, but they can't cover up sound.
Yeah.
So I go to the back, and they were chanting. I
Okay.
said, "Oh no. Those spirits don't come into my house." So I do know that a shofar is a very spiritual war instrument.
Okay.
So I took out my shofar and I didn't open the door, the sliding glass door, but right
Okay.
there I started blowing continuously the shofar, proclaiming that God sends angels of fire, ministering angels. I sent confusion to the enemy's camp. No more than 5 minutes took place and they had left. Bless my land with oil. I plead the blood of Jesus around my land. I call my land blessed, prosperous, and I mind my business.
So what do you, but I guess going back to my original question, what do you do for somebody who kind of sees the neighbors, but you're going to buy this house, you just moved in, so you really don't know that much about your neighbors, unless it's very obvious. But let's say for the, it's not. Is there something they should do on their property, like you said, as far as anointing or anything, just in case?
Well, Marlene, the one with the power and the authority is a person purchasing the property.
Of course.
So if they're planning on buying it or have bought it,
Right.
I'll bless the property, speak Psalms into it, call it blessed, be thankful for the land, repent if any witchcraft took over that land, if any wrongdoing was in that land, and say, "Lord, I thank you that all those curses are broken," and just anointed with oil from point A to point B, the
Okay.
measurements of the property, bless it. But you do this continuously. At least do it every other month and
Okay,
bless
so
you.
it's not like a one-shot deal. You got to work on it in case something
Oh.
that wasn't there before comes in or whatever, right? In other words, it's an ongoing process.
It's an ongoing process. Nothing is instant. It's an ongoing process. Yes, the Bible says that we need to be vigilant. So we continuously bless our property, bless our lands, bless our animals
Okay.
that dwell in the land.
Now let me ask you something, because you mentioned something that you said there's some pastors or some churches that understand what you're talking about, and there's others that don't really either know about it or work with it. What do you say to somebody who belongs to a church where they don't talk about this, or they're not knowledgeable about it, or they just don't like, they're just, that's not their thing? And how do you, what advice do you give somebody that, like, hey, you don't want to insult your pastor or maybe your other fellow, people that go to the church with you, but how do you go about getting more information or going down this path if you think that spiritual warfare, territorial warfare, you might think might, like you did, like what happened to you, that you realized at some point there's something here that I need to find out about. What advice do you give somebody that finds themselves in that situation?
Number one, they don't have to insult their pastors. There's such a thing as YouTube. They can Google spiritual warfare, territorial warfare, find out preachers that are teaching this, listen to what they're teaching, and start educating yourself. The Bible says that we perish for lack of knowledge. We.
Okay.
It's a personal thing. You don't have to leave your church. You just need to educate yourself that there's more. And
Okay.
if someone wants to find out more, they're free to email me.
Okay, which was exactly what I was going to ask you, but I'll tell you what, because besides the, my advice is let's your email, let them contact you directly. I don't want you to give out your email here on the show. I'd rather them go to where can what do you do? Do you have a website? Do you have a Facebook? How can they connect with you?
Facebook,
Okay. What how are you listed on Facebook?
Carmen Lopez Ministries.
Ministries like with RIES at the end
Correct, RIES.
on Facebook. They can connect from with you there, and then if they need to follow up with you, they can email you or instant message you on Facebook. Is that right?
That's correct.
And Carmen, I know there's people that are going to want to know, not only about connecting about you, but like you said, you made a point, do you have or will you have information, whether it's a show or podcast or tapes, somebody that wants to get more information on this because they think that maybe the root of their problem lies in this direction, and maybe the church they're attending or the people around them, they're not going to get any help from them. Do you can they go to your to Facebook for you, and you might have
Absolutely.
material for them?
Absolutely. They can write me on Messenger
Okay.
notification in Facebook under Carmen Lopez Ministries.
Okay. All right. And they
And
can
they
take it from there once they touch, once they explain to you what it is that they're looking for, you can help orient them in the right direction as depending on what it is that they want to know about, I imagine, right?
That's correct. That's correct. That's
Okay.
correct.
So, and because as YouTube is seen around the world, so I imagine that there's people in other parts of the world, and you made reference, you've worked not only in the United States, but you've gone to other countries.
Oh,
Okay.
I've been all over the globe.
Right. You've been to a lot of other countries, where there's some like what you were describing, the territorial warfare, where there's some version of that in that country that's affecting not only the land, but the people that live in that area. So,
Oh, yeah.
and you know what? And I'm going to ask you this. Do you think that people, let's say you have an area like you described where there's murders, there's dark dealings, it's just a bad area. And that's why I had asked you, are there people living there? Do you think that those people that live in that area or on the perimeter of it become a, like it bleeds into their lives where they start becoming bad people? You understand what I'm saying? People that maybe when they moved there, they were okay, and then because they are live so close or in that land, it starts to change who they are or what they do.
Yes, it does, unless they belong or have a strong church that believes in spiritual warfare and
Okay.
knows how to come about this. I mean, in that church that I was telling you that I visited in Venezuela, that's an hour from Cúcuta, when
Okay.
the pastor first invited me there, she told me through Skype, she goes, "I'll have you know that in this town, 28 people wake up dead every day
Oh my God. And that's from what? From murders?
for murders." Yes, people get into scrabbles and they shoot themselves
Boy,
and they
she must be
shoot
really
others.
busy there.
Yes, but I've known her now for 6 years, and that town has totally turned around.
That's good news.
Yeah, I mean, from 28 dead to three, I mean, that's a big
Yeah, that's a that's an improvement, I would say.
But her church has tripled. More people are taught on this. More teams are out praying in different sectors of the community. There's prayer just about 24 hours a day. The territory is always being prayed for. What happens where there's a lot of prayer in a territory? Crime comes down.
Okay, yeah, of course, right. It's like a trickle effect.
These people have actually have learned how to go out and pray and to shut down discotheques, to shut down pornography. And guess what? The businesses have shut down. And the pornography has shut down. I remember when I really had to pray and ask God, does he want me going to that town?
Okay. Because I imagine, let me. Let's and I want to ask you about the practical, the reality of going to some of these places. I imagine they're dangerous for you as well, right?
Yes, they are. And I play it very, very safe, as safe as possible. God has not called me to do things out of the ordinary. He wants my best well-being. But
Okay.
I remember when I first got to that town, I didn't go alone. I took someone with me.
Okay.
Because God always sent them two by two. So I got there and they placed me on one town only has two hotels.
Okay.
But guess what? That hotel was pleasant enough for that area, very
Okay.
clean. But the next door neighbor was a discotheque. So it was 3, 4 in the morning, and my walls are vibrating. Boom, 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 boom,
And
boom,
you were
boom.
the strobe with the light was still going on, huh?
Yeah. And I'm thinking, okay, I'm supposed to wake up at 7 and teach this stuff.
Yeah.
But guess what? I went back 3 years later and the disco had closed down.
Okay, there you go. No more the thump, the thump, the thump.
No. So this stuff works. There's people here in the US, friends of mine in the Oregon Territory, that they get up early in the morning and they go to the high places, to the courthouses, and they just walk around the block or around the steps and pray for governments and they pray for judges and they pray for peace and they pray that all that's in darkness comes into the light, and that God puts pious people in a leadership position, that drug deals break, that the cops find drug houses.
Okay.
Things are taking place to change communities and bring families together.
Now let me ask you, because Carmen, even though I think I might know the answer to this, but I'm still going to ask you. Like you said, they go to these specific places and they pray and they, they anoint, whatever the case might be, but remotely can groups of people pray for certain areas to improve, or do they have to be there physically?
No, they could pray remotely because, like I said earlier, there's no time or distance in the spirit.
Okay.
So whatever you pray, that goes straight to the spirit realm. Those angels know what to do with that prayer.
Okay, so it doesn't, they don't have to be physically there,
Correct.
to an intercede or to offer a prayer for whatever, whatever, like you said, if it's an area that's got high crime and murder and all these horrible things going on, that they could say, well, even if I'm on the, on another part of the world, I can still do something about it.
Absolutely. You could be right off of Skype like we are and be interceding with two or three Christians over the Middle East,
Okay.
over things and events that are happening in our countries, in our state. It
Okay.
doesn't matter because there's no time or distance in the spirit realm.
All right, Carmen, it has been great to interview you. Okay, and I am definitely going to bring you back because I know that there's a lot of listeners, whether they don't have any knowledge or they had some knowledge about this, but want to know more, okay, about the specifics. Okay, and especially what I thought was so riveting was when you gave these stories about things that you've experienced firsthand. Because, like I tell everybody, you can read a dozen books, or, but when you have that firsthand experience in front of you, that you live it, you understand what I'm saying? I think that that's the key to that you finally like absolutely accept the reality of it. And I think that a lot of people, when they hear these stories that you were saying about things that you've done or you've seen, they're like, wow, you know, like, which is why, you know, one of the things that I admire about you is that it's not that you've heard the story, you've actually done it. You've been there. You've been to these locations where even your personal safety was at risk, you know, because, like you said, these are areas where there's a lot of crime and, you know, people can do things sometimes without, you know, any fear of law enforcement. So that counts for a lot. So I definitely, when I come back, I would want you to talk about these things, about other stories, about things that you've experienced firsthand and what you've seen and the like, and like what you said, the outcome. You know, I checked back on 1 or 2 years later, you know, this had changed for the
Yes.
positive.
And
Okay.
I like to, with your permission, I'd like to add, Marlene, that I advise, whomever's listening, not to do any of this unless they know how.
Oh, I'm glad you brought that up. I'm
To
glad you brought that
play
up. Go
safe.
ahead.
I've spent years learning on it. I've had great mentors. I learned how to do this. At first, I'd fly with my mentor or people that practice this. I learned,
Okay.
so I've been at this for the past, I want to say, 9 years.
Okay.
But if anybody is a warrior and they know in their heart they've been called to pray for the nation, they have a heart to see people delivered, to have territories delivered, start blessing your property.
Okay.
At the most, start walking around the block, blessing it in the name of Jesus, declaring peace. Declaring that all the couples that live here will stay together, whatever God puts in your heart.
So in other words, they can start off small, like in their own backyard, for lack of a better thing.
Yes, that's how I started.
Okay.
You know,
And at
small.
the same time, I imagine that then the wise thing besides the mentoring is to get books or to get materials so that they start reading about it, right?
Absolutely. I have classes that I teach online. On these subjects,
Right, because sometimes people mistakenly think that good intentions is all you need, but there's a practical aspect to this. It's just not like
and
wanting to
foolish.
help.
No,
It's
I'd
just
be
the
very
beginning.
foolish. Start praying for your property, for your house, for your block, for the school that your kids attend. Walk it. Walk it. Because for those of us who have received the Lordship of Jesus Christ in our lives, the presence of the living God live in us. So when we walk our area, if we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, God lives in us. So when we walk, who's walking? It's God walking in us. As a matter of fact, nowhere in the Bible did Jesus or anybody call us Christians.
Okay.
We're small gods.
Right.
We're the mobile house of the Holy Spirit.
Right, and a lot of people fail to recognize that, or like you said, I think a lot of people give up their power. They don't realize like what you've said that they do have that power. They kind of like think that they're helpless, or that they're kind of at the mercy of a fate. You know, they have no control and their life is out of their hands, and or that they have not even thinkable that they have power to banish, to pray and say, I want these bad things to go away from this area or from, like you said, their homes or their, you know, the block they live on or the school where their kid goes to. A lot of people don't think they have that power.
They do have that power, and I have a noon. God has given me a hunger to pray for our nation. And I have a noon prayer with a toll-free number, which I'll give it to you, and you could post it online, whatever you
No,
want
do you
to
have
do.
it there?
No, not in
Okay,
the.
well, you give it to me and I'll post it in the credits of the show. Don't worry.
All right. And up to 100 people could call at noon.
Okay.
And we pray for the president. Listen, this is not about Obama or about Trump. God said in the Bible, first of all, pray for those who are in authority that you might live a peaceable life. And this is acceptable to the Lord. So I want to pray for the president, whether it's Obama, Trump, or whomever comes, because
Okay.
God said it. Because God said it. That we might live a peaceable life. So I remember a little while ago, that I was interested in how many departments or districts Miami has, and it
Okay.
has a team. I started to find out from the website what's the name of the leading person, the chairman, the council, the director of these 13 districts were. And we would lift up their names every day with a prayer partner, and we'd speak their names, and we'd ask God to bless them if they weren't born again, that their eyes be open to the truth of the gospel of the living God, and that they receive Jesus as Lord. And then we also prayed that whatever they were doing in darkness, that it would come to the light.
Okay.
That Miami might be known for not a magic city, but a city of light and
Okay.
of truth and transparency. And I remember in the course of 2 weeks, a council from Sweetwater was caught that someone paid him off $3,000 to approve a bid.
Oh, I think I
And
heard about that. I do believe I think I heard about that.
that was 2 weeks of prayer. And then another one in North Miami got caught for something else. See, there's things that you do in the natural, in prayer, that in the spirit, it carries weight.
Okay.
And none of us were called with a purpose and a destiny. And a lot of us have a hunger to see our communities change, our schools, and we're not helpless.
So I imagine, yeah, that a lot of people, like I said before, sometimes they feel helpless, that they have no power, they have nothing that they can offer or do, on their end. And from what you're describing, yes, they do. They do have.
They do, and they could contact me at Carmen Lopez Ministries in Facebook, and
Okay.
I'll
I'm
give
going to
them the
put that in the credits of the show.
number.
So as a link so that people can go there, Carmen, and they can get more information because I'm sure there's going to be people who do want to know more about this. Okay. And absolutely, I'm going to bring you back on. But thank you so much for appearing. Your information has been fantastic. Okay? It has been great, as a matter of fact. And I know that a lot of people are going to really enjoy it, everything that you described. And I know there's going to be a lot of questions. So absolutely, I'm going to be bringing you back on, and I'll let everybody know ahead of time that you're going to be appearing on the show. Okay?
Yes, let me just, with your permission, pray for the
Sure.
audience
Of course.
and for yourself.
Yes, thank you.
Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that the word of God that you gave me has fallen into good soil, the soil of the people's hearts, and it produces fruit, fruits of life, fruits of salvation, fruits that their children are blessed, that their family be blessed, that they all come to your knowledge, that their animals be blessed, Lord God. I pray that those who are facing negative circumstances, that this will shed light onto them, Lord, light of hope, light of life. I ask you to protect every single one of them, Lord, with the blood of Jesus. Father, I thank you for your angels of fire encamp around them, taking care of them and taking care of their vehicle, Father. Your heavenly protection is around all of them, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen.
Amen. Okay,
Okay.
Carmen.
Thank you so much, Marlene.
No, thank you. Take care. All right. And have a good, wait a minute. I've lost track today. So it's almost the weekend. Have a good weekend.
Thank you, too.
Sometimes I lose track of what day it is. Okay. It was great to talk to you. Okay.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Hi, everybody. How are you doing? So what did you think? Let me tell you something. Some of the things she spoke about, I know there's a lot of people that find themselves exactly in the position she found herself. Okay? Because everybody thinks that when people have epiphanies of, maybe that they're living a bad life, or they're engaged in a risky behavior, or just, the people they hang out with, and then they have that one moment where they're saying, "Well, I better get myself out of here." But she did have that moment. But later on, 20 years later, she was in a church. She was working with people around her that were spiritual, but she still realized that there was something she was just not getting. Okay. And I think that happens to a lot of people. It doesn't mean that you have to be in a bad place in your life to think I need more information or that there's something else going on that's holding me back. And I think that's one of the very important messages that Carmen had was, yeah, it's great if you're able to steer yourself off the path of destruction, but you could also be doing okay, but you just find yourself either not able to overcome certain either challenges in your life. Maybe everything else is good, but this one place you have a challenge, or spiritually you think there's something that I'm missing out. There's a piece of the puzzle that is just not fitting in together. Okay. And I'm going to mention this because this is to me, and this is my own personal belief, this has nothing to do with religious belief or denomination. Okay. I think a lot of people in their spiritual lives come up and find themselves in this predicament, okay, regardless of what their religious beliefs are. And what she said about as far as curses and family, your family vows that of poverty or things that have happened, this is legitimately espoused by a lot of religious beliefs that yes, that whether your ancestor or whoever it was did it maybe unknowingly, they did not do it with the intentions of thinking that they were going to cause trouble for their children or grandchildren or so forth. It does. I've seen this happen. I've heard of people that what we talked about, the people have taken the vow of poverty. One of the vows that people in as Catholics take their in the religious life is a vow of poverty. And that's a and if you say, well, this is a personal vow that that person's taken, that's different. But what we're talking about is that descendants sometimes are affected by that vow, and it almost like the bloodline is held to that vow, where you kind of like, if poverty doesn't follow you, you kind of sabotage your best intentions to escape poverty. Okay. And sometimes, and you'll have people say, God, everything I do just doesn't work out. And it's not for lack of trying, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And then this is where the answer lies. And I think this is why it was so interesting to talk to Carmen about this, and what she talked about territorial warfare. I know there's a lot more to this. I know, we talked about a very overall picture of it, but you could tell, when she was talking about parts of the world where a lot of human blood has been spilled and bad things happen, and anybody who has any type of spiritual presence or knowing understands what happens to the land, to the earth, what she was talking about, the interconnectedness of everything, between humans and what surrounds us. Physics is proving it for the scientists in the crowd, as far as the interconnectedness and that things, even though our eyes tell us they're separate, in reality they're not. But spiritually, I mean, I believe it, I feel it, I've experienced it, and everybody's different. This is, like I said, this is my opinion, my own personal belief that yeah, that we are interconnected. And I think that when we separate ourselves as humans from the world around us, whether it's the plants, the land, the animals, the atmosphere, the everything, we do it at our own risk. And I think that it hurts us. I think that as humans, when we have emotional ties, not only to other human beings, but to everything around us. And by this, don't get me wrong. Like, for example, some people say, well, I'm not an animal person. I'm not saying that you have to go around and adopt 100 dogs and, be the cat lady on the block. No. But you know what? There's something where you appreciate nature, okay? Or, you don't go out of your way to hurt animals. You don't have to be an animal person. Same thing with a plant. I personally, I'm one of those people that, some people have a green thumb. They'll stick anything, or they'll stick a stick in the dirt and you get a tree. I'm not one of those people. I would love to be one of those people, but for me to have things grow, it has to be like a cactus, Little attention, just some sun, a little rain. I do great with cactuses. But you know what? I appreciate trees. I appreciate fruit trees. I appreciate shade trees. That's what I'm saying. I think that we separate ourselves at great risk from everything that surrounds us. And this has nothing to do either with spiritual beliefs or, anything like that. I think that just to be a happy human being, that usually helps. So anyway, now that we're at the end of the show, I'm glad you came and you joined me. I really enjoyed producing this show for you. I would like to get your comments. Like I said in the credits, I'm gonna, not only include my contact information as far as my websites and blah blah blah, but also information about how to reach Carmen on Facebook. Which is a jumping off point if you need more information from her, and whatever, if you have a question for her, which I do for all of my guests. And I hope you come back every week. Hit the like button, subscribe to my channel. As I've always told you, I look for interesting people from different aspects, from different belief systems, from different, to come to my show and speak about what they know, what they've experienced, what they've seen. Okay, because whether you accept it or believe it or anything, I'm going to use that old adage, a mind is like a parachute. It only works if you open it. So I think that one of the roads to this is looking and listening to other areas that are different from what you know or what your experience or what you've been taught. And whether you agree with it or you don't agree with it, it doesn't matter, but as long as you're willing to listen. I think that's great. Like I said, I'm always the student, always the student. I think I'll always be the student until that's it. Marlene is gone. So again, here we're almost on the weekend, so I'm hoping you all have a great weekend. Please come back next week. I'm going to be putting up, I believe my next guest is going to be Jim Smith from Alabama Bigfoot Society. Hello. Yes, I spoke to Mr. Smith on the phone. He's been doing this since 1971. He's been working, and not only, collecting information, he has his own stories, he has his own sightings. I could have spent 5 hours talking to this man. He's got so many interesting things to talk about. Believe me, he's seen it all. I mean, he even gave me a story of this first sighting, which I believe was either 15 or 18. Okay. And he told me this was the last thing he expected to see was a Bigfoot. So anyway, that's going to be my next guest. And like I said, I'll post things up, ahead of time that's going to be my next guest. But the way you're always going to get notifications if you subscribe to my channel. And that's what I'm hoping you're going to do. So until next time, have a great day. Have a great weekend. Take care. Bye.